Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
So today's first session will be delivered by Mr. Nitul Jhaveri, sir. He will be talking on the remainder part of analyze phase of Lean Six Sigma. So without wasting time, I welcome Nitul, sir, to start the session. Sir, you can start the session, sir.
So we have a few participants till now, but let us start actually. So before we start, I would like to just refresh whatever has been discussed yesterday. So let us quickly refresh what we discussed yesterday. So first of all, if you have any questions or something like that in yesterday's session, please feel free to ask. You have any questions, or else I will just start with my. So what we discussed yesterday was about this steps of analyze phase. Okay, so in analyze phase, we also discussed about this equation y is equal to function of x. Okay, I explained you what is the meaning of this equation. And in analyze phase, basically what we do is we analyze the x. Okay, we analyze the various axes. Okay, and how do we do this actually? To do this, we use a concept which is called a funneling concept. So we use a funneling concept where we filter all the causes. Okay, so this is exactly like a funnel concept actually. So what we do is we have some potential causes, and then we will have some probable causes, okay, and then we finally have the root causes. Now before we go from this potential to probable, we have a major filter over here. And what is that filter? And that filter is very important. That filter is called data analysis. Or validation, and we also use something called GEMBA. So GEMBA means we go to the place and verify. So data will give us about information about the various factual information of the data. GEMBA will give us some facts, okay, about the entire thing actually. I also explained you how do we do this, how do we identify potential causes, how do we identify the probable causes, and how do we do the data analysis and fact verification. So for potential causes, we use a technique called brainstorming. And then we arrange this data into a diagram, which is called CE diagram. To come to the probable causes out of this, so we have a first filtration. So we use either multivoting, or we use FMEA to filter the causes, or we can do some kind of graphical analysis. Okay. So these are some of the techniques that we can use to filter this. Now here, the data analysis, we use one of the important tool, which is called hypothesis testing. Now in hypothesis test, what we do is we have different claims about the population parameter, and we accept or reject the claims based on our analysis. Okay, so we'll take the sample. And based on the sample, we will either accept the scenario, or we will reject the scenario. So this is what we have discussed yesterday. Once after hypothesis testing and gamma analysis and some other graphical analysis, we can use other tools also here apart from hypothesis. If the causes are validated, only then we will consider them as final root causes. Otherwise, we will not consider this as a final root causes. Okay, so that's how we will we actually do this. I also showed you example of one chemical company. I also showed you example of one IT company actually. So let me ask a few questions to understand whether the yesterday's concepts were clear or not actually. Okay, so let us say there is an automobile company, and this automobile company had to recall its product. So you recall the product, you know what is product recall. Product recall means you are calling the products back from the customer. Why the product was recalled? Because there was some defects, and these defects were not identified by the company when they did the inspection or quality control or whatever it may be. Now, yesterday in hypothesis testing, we discussed about two type of error. Okay, that is called alpha error and beta error. So this example of product recall, what kind of error is this? Is it alpha error or is it beta error? If anybody can answer me. What kind of error is this? Is it alpha error or is it beta error?
Beta error.
Yes. So this is called a beta error because you fail to...
Sir, excuse me, sir. Sir, please repeat the situation, sir.
So there is an automobile company. Okay, for example, in automobile companies now it's very common that they recall the products. So when they recall the products, what they do is they call the products back from the market. If you see recently, Toyota had recalled more than many vehicles actually from the market because there was some issue in the brake. Okay, so now the product was recalled because the product was actually faulty, but the quality department or the in-house department was not able to identify that defect. So the product went into the market with defects. It skipped the defect from the company and it went to the market, and then the company had to recall this product. So there is an error in the inspection, right, at the factory end. So what is the error of inspection here? Is it an alpha error or beta error, or we can also call it type 1, type 2 error? That is the question. That is the situation.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. So this is called beta error. Why? Because their product was faulty, but we could not, detect that particular situation. Okay, so if you remember yesterday we discussed about this and I explained you if you see I yesterday I explained you about this alpha error and beta error. So what is alpha error here? If you see, what do we mean by alpha error and beta error? So for example, here we have a situation where there is this verdict. If you see here, set the person free, that is a verdict of the judge. Okay, and what is the current real situation? The real situation is that the person is guilty. Same thing has happened in our case also. We have allowed the product to go, but actually the product was guilty, or guilty in the sense the product was faulty. Okay, here in our case. So that is called type 2 error, or it is called beta error. There can be other case also. Yesterday also we discussed the other case where we said we punish the product. We say this is faulty, and actually upon re-inspection you come to know that the product is not faulty. Okay, so that is called also error in judgment, and that error is called type 1 error. Okay, let me give you a very practical context to this. Recently in this COVID situation, you may have come across a lot of cases where a person was tested positive, and then after repeat test, you know, let's say you go for antigen test and you find that there is a COVID. When you go for the RT-PCR test, you come to know he's not there is no, you know, COVID this traces actually. So that's also error in the judgment. In COVID, you know, analysis, there are a lot of errors are there actually. If you see, there was a huge report also in the paper that there are a lot of errors actually in the way the laboratories are doing the testing. Similarly, you can also say that there is no COVID, and when you do the RT-PCR, you will come to know that there is a COVID. Or you do some two, three repeat tests, you will come to know that there is a COVID. Okay. So this kind of judgmental error will be always there. So what we do in this phase is in hypothesis testing. We assume in the beginning what kind of risk that we want to take. So this error is nothing but a risk. Okay. So there is a risk of judgment. What we do is we usually take this alpha risk. Okay. So what we do is we take the alpha risk.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
Compared to the analogy that you have given,
yes,
that a culprit is lead free is alpha kind of error, is not? He committed mistake, and the judgment is he was okay. Lead free. Am
yeah.
I correct, sir?
Yes. Yes.
But that is not much dangerous, because compared to an innocent being punished.
Exactly.
Yes, sir. But in the case of the example, the automobile example that you have given, when a faulty vehicle goes out to the market, that is more dangerous.
Yes.
Compared to being rejected a good vehicle, or is it not, sir?
Yes.
But in this, both a culprit being let out and a faulty vehicle go into the market, both are alpha error, is it not, sir?
Yes. Now see, I think you have pointed out very good this thing, point of discussion. So whether which risk you have to take, okay? So both the places we have a risk. Now for example, you know, you said like the vehicle is going into the market, there is a consumer risk. And if the company keeps on rejecting the product at the company, which is actually okay product, and if it keeps on rejecting the product, that is a producer risk, okay? So you have to always balance this producer risk and consumer risk. Now let us take example of mission critical activities. Let's say we are designing something or we are producing something for the aerospace. What kind of error you will likely to take more? Which kind of risk you are ready to take more?
Producer's risk.
Yeah, because see what happens is you have to do n number of inspections. You don't want that product to fail in the airspace, because it's a costly, you know, affair actually. And this is a one time. I mean, you cannot repeat. We cannot send our Mangalyaan to the Mars again actually. It's very costly. It takes years to build that particular product. So there, they will not think about alpha risk. They will talk more about beta risk. They are ready to take beta risk. They are ready to, you know, because there is a risk. What is the risk? They will have more cost of inspection. But they want to take that risk, not an issue. Okay. So it all depends on the kind of the products that we are talking about. It all depends on the situation. So that's a very good, example. So I think with this space mission example, which I have given, now I think it should be clear. You have to always decide about which risk you want to take more. Okay? Not every time you decide on alpha risk. Sometimes you also take more beta risk. Okay.
Yes.
I hope I am able to clear. Yeah.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, very good. So now, in hypothesis testing, by default, what you said very correctly, actually, that the judge will do what? You know, we have this in Hindi movie, we also always have this dialogue, actually. You know, 100 gunegar chhoot jayega, lekin ek beguna ko saja nahi milna chahiye. So, bale, the risk that the judgment, the court judge system takes is that innocent should not be punished, okay? So here also, innocent should not be punished means we are talking about alpha risk. So in hypothesis testing also, we take into account the alpha risk. So we determine the alpha risk in the advance. By default, we take 5% alpha risk. when it is 5% alpha risk means my confidence is nothing but 95%. Okay, when I take alpha risk of 1%, that means my confidence is 99%. But then alpha and beta risk is opposite of each other. So when you take one risk, the other risk will increase. Okay, if you reduce one risk, the other risk will increase. If I take 10% error, you know, alpha error, then my confidence will be 90%. So usually in any statistical analysis, we either take 90 or 5 or 1% alpha risk. By default, most of the softwares will take 95% as a risk. Okay, well, that's in middle actually. So 95% is good enough to reject actually. So we have enough confidence. At the same time, we are not taking much chances of error also. Okay, now so this is what a very important thing that we have discussed yesterday. Now in hypothesis testing, what we do is people make different claims. Okay, so we have claims like somebody will say it is happening because of machine, or machine one is better than machine two, or something like that. Or you can say material one is better than material two. Okay, so all these claims people will make, now everywhere you go into the Six Sigma root cause analysis, people have different claims. So what we want to do is we want to either accept or reject these claims by the people, and that is where we use this hypothesis testing. Okay, so what we do is we typically identify, first of all, what is our alternative hypothesis. So for example, so we use this terminology HO, which is called null hypothesis, okay, and alternative hypothesis. Now in null hypothesis, what is always assumes the equality, so it will have equal to sign. In alternative hypothesis, we will have either greater than or less than or not equal to sign. These are the three symbols that we have. Okay, so null hypothesis means it is always assuming the equality, like the judge always will assume that the person is innocent. Okay, and same case here also. If I am doing a research on medicine, we are doing some research on, let's say, vaccine for COVID. We have produced some combination of the vaccine. When I want to do a trial, I'll first assume there is no effect. Okay, I will start with that assumption, and then so that is the by default I would say assumption, that is called null hypothesis. But the researcher's view is what? Researcher says, no, my medicine is effective, my vaccine is effective. Okay, but alternative will be that is always that it is equal to sign. So we use this kind of symbols. Okay, now we have claims for a few things. One is the mean, one is the standard deviation, and one is the proportion of the population. Okay, these are the usually three claims that we have. If I have only one population, I will say my mu one is greater than some value, let's say any value, let's say in case of if I'm measuring some two, comparing two materials, I'll say this particular material is having viscosity of 20 or something like that. So I will have this kind of claim. So I will accept this or reject this. Okay, I can also have claims like that two populations. So I'll say mu one is greater than mu two. Okay, I have two different machines. I will say machine one is better than machine two. Similarly, I can also have hypothesis for standard deviation. So I can say my sigma is more than some value, or I can say my sigma one is greater than sigma two, or sigma one is less than sigma two, or I can also say sigma one is not equal to sigma two. Okay, so like that I will have a claim. Okay, same here also, it is possible mu one is less than mu two, or mu one not equal to mu two. Similarly here for proportion also, I can have the same thing. My proportion is more than some value, or less than some value, or is not equal to some value. I can have proportion one and proportion two, and I can say it is less than, greater than, or not equal to. Okay, so this is how I will have the claims, different claims. So all these claims can be proven in Minitab. So in Minitab we have a provision. You can also see, I have explained you yesterday, we have this graphical analysis in the assistant you go to hypothesis test, and Minitab will give you this entire decision making table. Okay, you can use this decision making table and perform your different hypothesis testing. Okay, now yesterday we did some exercise on hypothesis testing. Okay, and we did around t-test, and we did the 2t test. We also did the proportion test also. Let us try one more analysis in Minitab. So if you can just open this particular worksheet which I will copy, maybe I have already given to you. So let us understand now paired t-test. There is something called paired t-test in Minitab. This is there in many other softwares also. So I'm just copying this in the chat box. If you can download this and install this in Minitab software, I hope you have. This is the worksheet sample file. Just copy this file, and I'll also show you the case study. What is the case study? This is the case study. I'll just copy this case study just for a reference so that I can enlarge this, and I will paste it over here. You can now read this case study. The case study says that there is a physiologist, and this physiologist is making some study, and he wants to determine whether running is effective, or is it what is the effect of running on the resting heart rate. Okay, so your heart pulse rate, what is the effect? And he takes 15 random selected people are taken for the study, and these people are put on the running program. So you see the same population, that means same people. So they are measuring. So before 1 year, these people were not having regular running. After 1 year's program, these people are using some regular exercise and running and all that. And now what is he doing is he's making a before and after measurement. So in Six Sigma also, you also have to do this before and after measurement. So when you want to do this before and after comparisons, whether my project has improved or not, if you want to do this kind of thing, you know, then you always use this paired t-test. Okay. So now here we have this data. This data is there in the Minitab. Yeah, this is the data. So you see, I have the before 1 year, I had collected the data. Now, one thing you have to remember, when do you do paired t-test and when do you do two sample t-test? So you have to just understand this. When you do, what is the difference? So two sample t-test versus paired t-test. Here what I say is the same population. Here maybe it is a different population. So yesterday, if you saw, we saw did an example of two hospitals, hospital one versus hospital two. Now here the same population. Usually, if you want to compare before and after situation, you are giving some treatment and you want to compare before and after. In Six Sigma, after improvement, you want to see whether your project has really improved or not. Then you will use paired t-test. Okay, so that is the only difference. Okay. So now we have this data. What we will do is we will go to. So now, can anybody tell me what will be the null hypothesis in a paired t-test? H zero. What is the notation? We have two mu one, and mu two. This mu one is before. This mu two is after. What is the notation I should keep here? Which sign I should? Yeah. So which sign should I put here? Equal to, greater than, less than, not equal to, in null hypothesis. Before and after.
Yeah. Equal to.
Null hypothesis will always have equal to sign.
Equal sign.
Now we write down alternative hypothesis. We say mu 1 and mu 2. I'll say before. Mu 1 is before, mu 2 is after. Which sign should I put now? I'll put not equal to. Why? Because I'm just assuming that before and after there is no difference. Whether you run, you do not run, doesn't make any difference. So that's my alternative hypothesis. Or I can also say mu 1 minus mu 2 is equal to 0. The difference is 0. If I compare the mean before and if I compare the mean after, the difference is 0. That is what I can have. So I can have either, I can write it down like this, okay, or I can write it down like this. This is my alternative hypothesis. Now, if my p value, which is a probability value, if it is less than 0.05, I will reject the null hypothesis. I will reject this null hypothesis. So I will accept the alternative hypothesis. That means there is a difference. Okay. If my p value is more than 0.05, why 0.05? Can anybody tell me? Because our confidence level is?
Alpha level is 5%.
5%. And we are 95% confident. Okay, very good. So now let us do this in Minitab. So we'll go to stat, we go to basic statistics, we go to paired t-test, and here we have an option. If my data is entered in single column, multiple columns, or I am talking with summarized data. Now if you see here, my data is entered in two different columns. Okay. So what I will do is I will select here this sample 1 and sample 2. Okay. So I'll say before, I'll say after. Okay. Now I'll go to option. In option, by default, Minitab is taking 95% confidence level, which means alpha error is 5% or 0.05 inverse proportion. My hypothesized difference, what is the hypothesized difference? That means mu 1 minus mu 2 is equal to 0. That is what it is already taking, my Minitab. And if you see here, alternative hypothesis, we have only three symbols. The difference is less than the hypothesized difference. The difference is not equal to this, 0. Or the difference is more than 0. So whatever you want to compare, we'll select currently not equal to. When I select not equal to, and I just I can select the graphs also if I want. Minitab will give you a graphical representation also, and then we will just select OK. So now you see here, I have now this analysis which Minitab has given to me. I'll just go here. So you see, Minitab has given you null hypothesis is. I will just copy this somewhere so that you can read properly. You see now, this is the output Minitab has given. Okay, and Minitab has also given some graph also. Let us see this graph also. So these are all individual value plot of the differences. Let us take one of this graph. Okay. Now, what is our p-value here? Our p-value is 0.007. So what we should do? which what is accepted and what is rejected here. P value is 0.007. So please remember, yesterday I gave you a slogan: when P is low,
who should go?
Who should go? So what should go here? My null hypothesis should go. I just put a. So what does it mean? It means that alternative is correct. What does it mean? It means that the hypothesized difference is not zero. That means there is a difference. If you run before and after, there is a difference. Now, if you look at the chart, our hypothesized mean, that is H0, is here. What is hypothesized difference? Zero. We say there is no difference. What is the difference values coming here? And the difference values are coming somewhere here. If my and then this is the confidence interval of that. You know, if they say this is the 95% confidence. So this is, we are saying that, you know, this is out of this. So we cannot say that this is the same. There is a difference actually, okay? If my actual calculated value comes somewhere here, that's my X bar comes here, then I cannot, and if my confidence interval is like this, then I cannot say confidently that I can reject. But here I can reject the null hypothesis because it is outside of this my confidence interval. Okay, so this is how you will interpret the this thing actually. Okay, so with this graph also you can understand what how do we interpret this. Okay, so let us go ahead now. So like this you can do all this other and hypothesis analysis in Minitab. I hope now I'm able to explain you about this particular example. Any confusion, any doubt you have now in hypothesis testing, or shall we go ahead? Okay, let me ask you one simple question before we go ahead. So we were working for one diamond company in Surat. This diamond company was manufacturing diamonds and polishing diamonds, okay? And there is a group of operators actually. So what this company, so they have around 350 people who are doing the polishing actually. So now they wanted, there was a claim. The claim was this, that when the person is experienced, and what the problem what we were facing here was rework. So there are a lot of rework was there in the diamond. So the when we polish the diamond, we give it to lab, the lab will give it back to us. So there was around, let's say, this is surprisingly 300% rework. That means each diamond was coming three times back. Now we wanted to reduce this rework, okay? That was our project, Six Sigma. This is the actual case study, okay? And we got even national award also for this case study. So now here, if I want to claim, there is a claim. The claim is, can you give me now, how do I test this? How do I accept or reject this statement? What should I do? If you are in my place, what would you do?
Left tail test.
Okay. So can you just help me with the statement? How should I have my null and alternative hypothesis? Yeah, you are correct actually.
The null hypothesis.
First of all, let's say we group the operators, okay? Let me simplify this for you. Let's say we group the employees. We have two groups, okay? So we have group one of operator and we have group two of operator. So the group one of operator is all having less than 10 years of experience, and group two is having more than 10 years of experience, okay? So now I want to compare these two. Okay, so what will I do now? Now you can, now it is easy for you to, you know, decide actually. So what I can do is
g1 equal to g2,
mu1 is equal to
okay.
mu2, and here I will say mu1 minus mu2 is not equal to 0. Okay, that is one. Or I can say mu2 is greater than
mu1. Okay.
Okay, I can also say like that. I can do mu, I can also do proportion test, P test also. Okay, I can say P1 is equal to P2 proportion, and I can also say proportion means out of this how many defects are there. Okay, or P1 less than P2. Okay, so we did the same thing for this company, and then we proved, you know, and it was actually proven that the operator's experience does matters actually. But now the question is, what do I do? Shall I remove all these people who are having less than 10 years of experience? No, we cannot do that. So what do we do? So we had a very specific training program. How? That means that people to have certain skills takes time, up to 10 years. How can I do this in, let's say, 3 years? How can I have a skill equivalent to 10 years in just 3 years of training of employee? So we did devised a, you know, complete training module for this company where we can train the employees within 3 years rather than within 10 years. Okay, so how do we do that? So that is what the entire solution was on that particular aspect. This is one of the case. So I hope with this kind of example you are able to understand how to. The Six Sigma is, you know, really very powerful. I'd say, you know, people, I mean, as you say, Dr. Deming's statement, I always like this: in God we trust, all others bring data and facts. Okay, so data and facts can really, there is no room for politics. See, otherwise what happens if you don't have this kind of analysis? People will just claim anything. Okay, and we cannot conclude anything actually, but we will prove always with the data, okay, that this makes a difference. So let us now go ahead with our other module, okay, the next module. So I think you can also practice the other, I would say, yeah. So let's go ahead now with the next module, that is the last module of analyze phase, okay. So this is now, the last module. So in this module we are going to discuss about scatter plot, regression, pug metrics, and DFSS tool overview and benchmarking. Okay, so very quickly, okay, we'll go to the, so now there is another possibility of analyze. You see, there are different, as I told you, statistics is all that, how can you make your data talk to you? That is what statistics is all about. How can you convert your data so that your data starts speaking to you? The data starts talking to you. Okay, that's what we are doing. So if I want to check, for example, a relationship of two parameters, variable parameters, then I can use this method which is called scatter plot and regression. So usually if we have two variables, all the two variables are, you know, let's say continuous variable, then I can use this kind of scatter plot to understand the correlation. What happens in the scatter plot? It tells us whether these two variables are related with each other or not. Let us say, for example, stock market. If I'm talking about stock market, if every day in India I have the stock index, you know, BSE and NSE. So if I want to compare the BSE and NSE, is it correlation? Definitely there will be a good correlation. But let's say I want to compare the BSE Sensex with New York, NASDAQ. Okay. If I compare, so what I will do is on one column, I will put all the data of BSE. On other column, I can put all the data of NASDAQ, and I can do some, perform some analysis and make sure whether there is any correlation there or not actually. Okay, so this is what I can establish. We can do the correlation analysis for two y's, that is y1 and y2. We can also do the two correlation for x1 versus x2, But most probably what we do is we do the correlation with X and Y. That is the most usual correlation. So in Six Sigma project, mostly we are trying to compare X and Y correlation. Okay, what is that correlation? So when the correlation can be linear or non-linear, or it can be single correlation, simple correlation, or it can be multiple. Yeah. Hello. Yeah. And we can also measure the strength of this relationship. Okay, so if BSE and NSE, BSE and NASDAQ is related, what is the strength of the relationship? I can also measure that with this particular exercise. Okay. So these are some examples, so you can immediately understand this. Let's say cutting speed versus tool life. So there is a correlation. So I can measure cutting speed on one axis and tool life on one axis and cutting speed on another axis. Okay. I can use experience versus salary, breakdown versus equipment life. Okay. It will have correlation, but not a simple correlation. It will have different correlation. Okay. It kind of a bathtub curve kind of a thing. Now I have credit score versus loan amount. Okay. Temperature versus percentage of the foam in the soft drinks. So that is, these are all different examples in real life where we can measure the, they have kind of a correlation, and we can measure this correlation statistically. Okay. So usually this is, on left side, whatever we have mentioned is called X variable. The Y side, what we have mentioned is called Y variable. So we have X and Y relationships. Okay. What we can do is we can create this kind of a scatter plot. Now what we have is, say for example, here in this case we have on one side we have ice cream sales on the Y scale, and on the X scale we have the temperature in degree centigrade. Now currently, recently you must have read in the newspaper, is a huge temperature rise in Canada. Okay. And so now we want to compare the temperature rise versus ice cream sales. Okay. So is there any correlation? And let's say this is a hypothetical situation. We found that there is this kind of patterns we got actually. Now what is this pattern actually? So you see here, there is a very simple scatter plot is created where we have, if you see here, this value. So when the temperature was 12, at the same time, the sales was some value less than 200 or something. When the temperature was 14, approximately the temperature, the sales was this. So what we have done is on one scale, we are just putting wherever they are intersecting, we are putting a dot like this. Okay. These are the all the readings actually. And you can see here now that there is one line is drawn over here. This line is basically called a regression line. Okay. Or it is also called best fit line. Okay, so we'll understand that later on. And I can draw this line, imaginary line, or I can also calculate this equation, and I can, based on that equation, I can put this line actually. Okay, mathematically, statistically, we can do all those things. Okay. This is a positive correlation. Because why we say positive correlation? Because here it is going in this direction. Okay, so that's called positive correlation. I can also have negative correlation like this, okay, where my values will be like this. So some places you will have negative correlation also, that's also possible. And if I get the values which are straight like this, I will say no correlation kind of a thing. Okay, so we have different kind of correlations are possible actually, and we can check this with this kind of graph. Okay, this is called scatter plot. This is, so now we have this scatter plot of absenteeism versus overtime. Okay, so we wanted to compare this in one particular company, and what we found is this company was claiming those people who are absent, what they do is next day they come, they do overtime and they compensate. So they were having this claim. So we measured absenteeism days versus overtime in hours. Okay, and what we found is that there is no correlation because the points are not in any particular direction. Okay, so I cannot say that there is any correlation. Okay, so we can have this like this, you know, we have different kind of patterns are possible. So this is called strong positive correlation. And the direction is like this. I can also calculate the value of correlation, which is called Pearson's coefficient of correlation. So I can calculate this R value, small r. So small r is, let's say here in this case, it is plus 0.9. I can also calculate, sometime I can also have this kind of figure. It is called, in my R value is minus 0.9. R value will be from plus 1 to minus 1. Okay, so it will be in between that range actually, okay, minus 1 to plus 1. Then I can have this kind of situation where I say R value is 0, it's no correlation. I can have this kind of correlation. So I say this is a possible, the correlation is not that strong, but still there is a correlation. It is plus 0.7, for example. This is minus 0.7. And I can also have this kind of relationship. This is called curvilinear relationship. This is not linear, it is not straight line, it's a curve actually. So I can also have this kind of relationships where up to a certain point of time it goes down and then again it increases. Okay, like the corona pattern that we have now, it's a curvilinear kind of a relationship, okay, or exponential kind of a relationship sometimes. So I can also calculate, based on this, I can also calculate something called capital R square. So the capital square R square is nothing but 100 multiplied by small r square. Okay. So here in this case, my capital R square is 81. Here also it is 81. The only difference in small r and capital R is that the small r gives you the direction. Capital R gives you the percentage of correlation. What percentage of relationship is explained by this variable? So these two together, 81% dependency on each other. Okay, so there are other, let's say out of 81, that is 100 minus 81 is 19%. So there are other 19% causes which are also influencing the Y. I don't know. But 81% cases, the Y will change because of this one x which we have mentioned over here. Okay, so like this we can do this. As I told you, the R value will be from minus 1 to 0 to plus 1. Okay, what we usually recommend is, you know, we can do this computation, which is small r value and capital R value in the correlation, but always we recommend to plot a scatter diagram. Okay, because sometimes you plot and you get some value, but not necessarily there is a correlation. So you have to always put a scatter diagram, okay, before you start any investigation. So you have to use graph and computation both, okay. Thus, another very important aspect in correlation, you know. Yesterday night I was watching news in the national television. And there was a debate, there was some survey, and this was on CNBC channel. The survey was that, you know, those people who are vegetarian, they have 73% less chances of COVID infection, severe COVID infection. And those for people who are non-vegetarian, they have 2 to 3 times higher chances of severe COVID infection. So they were debating on this. There was a panel of doctors and they were all debating on this. Now the survey result says that people who are, they may have done some sampling, and most and then based on that sampling they said, you know, people who are vegetarian, there's 73% likely cases you will not have severe COVID infection. How do you interpret this actually? So there was a lot of argument, and if you see, there are a lot of other things into this. Not only, I mean, you cannot say simply because person is vegetarian, he will not have COVID. Because in the sample, we don't know. There are other things. The What about the stress level of the people? What about the other habits of, let's say, drinking alcohol or some other things actually? So we don't know. Maybe their sample size was such that when the people who is having non-veg is also having more alcohol. So is it an idea? Maybe it is not related with vegetarian, non-vegetarian. It is related with alcoholism. We don't know. So some, we have to be very cautious when we do sometimes, you know, prove this kind of correlation. So we use this call, correlation does not imply causation. So for example, if you see, since I have mentioned over here that since 1950, both atmospheric CO2 level and obesity level has increased. Now, if you plot a chart of CO2 level versus the percentage of the people who are obese in the world, you will find a straight correlation. But is there any cause? Are there actually technically, you know, having any cause and effect relationship? There is no cause and effect relationship of CO2 versus obesity. So I cannot say, you know, the obesity is increasing because of the CO2 level. So that's not the correct claim, because there is no causation. So you see the correlation. Like, you see the correlation that vegetarian people are not having COVID. But is there any causation? I don't know. Actually, we have to have some other analysis also. Okay. So, I mean, that only a technical person can tell actually. Okay. Now you have to have a very strong, I would say, argument to say or to prove that there is a possible cause. These two things are correlated. Like if the tool life and the other thing which we were mentioned, if it is correlated, the engineer has to come and say, yes, there is a causation. Okay. So like this, you have to have correlation and causation has to be understood properly. Okay. So let's take this example. We have this example where we have local ice cream shop, which keeps track of how many sales and also is keeping track of temperature. This is a hypothetical case actually. So just you want to, for a study purpose, so we want to compare these two. So we have created this scatter plot and we have also got this correlation value, Pearson's correlation, and we are getting this correlation value as 0.957. okay, so this means that there is a high good correlation. P value is 0. Here P value means, is there any correlation or there is no correlation? So by default, my null hypothesis will be there is no correlation. When my P value is 0, which means there is a high correlation. Okay. So here we see there is a very weak correlation. There is no correlation. There is a volts and flash recovery. There is some battery company who has done some survey, and what they have found is there is a very, there is no correlation. Okay. So let me just, what happens in the, when you plot the scatter plot? The scatter plot will detect any outlier if possible. So for example, if we see, let me take, if I draw a chart like this, okay, and I have points which are like this, scattered like this, and I have one point over here, okay. So I can, you know, immediately make out that there is a, some unusual observation here actually, okay, which is there actually in my the reading. So I can call this as outlier, okay. Now I have to check whether this is an error, measurement error, or this is actual case. If this is actual case, maybe I have to collect some more data here, because there is some other kind of relationship possible. If this is a measurement error, I can remove this point and I can draw a, you know, correlation regression line actually. So that is possible. It can also detect the influential points. Okay, so sometimes let's say my influential point is, this is also called influential point in this case. Because if you mathematically, when you calculate the correlation value, it will give you a different value because it is also going to consider this value. So it will give you a different kind of mathematical result. So that is called influencing points actually. It can also, we can detect the data in group. Okay, so if there is any group which is possible, for example, if I create a scatter plot, and if I get a diagram like this, and then I have another values over here, and then. So what it means is I have maybe two groups, two kind of groups behavior actually. So maybe I can separate these two groups actually, this group and this group, and I can create another scatter plot and see what is the kind of relationship. Okay. Then I can also detect non-linearity in the this thing. So non-linearity may be possible, as I told you, that my data is not linear. Okay. It is having some this kind of relationship or something like that. Up to some point it goes up and then it goes down actually. Okay, so that is non-linearity. So it gives a quick approximation, scatter plot gives you a quick approximation and solutions. Okay, so let's understand about the regression line, how that regression line is drawn. So what we do is, in regression line is we calculate the differences. Okay, it is we calculate the differences. As you can see here, we have this line. So this is a hypothetical value here. There is a hypothetical value over here, and this. And then you can measure this vertical distance. This distance. I can measure this difference. So this is called my y, and this is called my predicted y. So I can calculate the difference of these y's, and that is how we draw. Now what happens is, my difference is ideally this will be positive and negative because the line is passing through the center. That is the best fit line actually. If you sum all these differences, so this is this this value versus this value versus this value versus this value. So if you take all the differences, so it will be positive and negative. So ideally your difference should be what? Ideally the line which is best where the difference is zero. Okay, what we do is we'll not sometimes get a correct answer in this. So in statistics, what we do is we square the differences, these negative values and positive values. So what we do is we will do a square. So whatever the difference is coming, y minus y predicted, we will square them. And that way we are also penalizing the extreme outlier values. So if I, let's say I have some values which are here. So this difference will be very large, okay? When I square this, it is also magnifying the value because I am squaring it. If it is 3, when I square it, it becomes 9. Okay. So if there is any extreme value, or let's say if this is 1 and this is 2, that difference is not much. But when it is 3, for example, I will square it, it will become 9. So I am penalizing the extreme values. Okay. So it is also called least square method. Okay. I think you hope you have read this. The least square method means when I add everything together, my total sum of square will be least, minimum as possible, and that is called best fit line. Okay, so in regression we have simple linear regression where we have one y and one x, and we have multiple linear regression where we have one y and multiple x. Okay, so this is exactly like the equation which I was talking to you in Six Sigma. So if you see here, this is y is equal to alpha plus beta x plus epsilon. So this alpha is nothing but my intercept, okay, and then beta is my slope, this x is my independent variable, y is my dependent variable. The epsilon is nothing but the error which is in the variable. If I have a multiple linear relationship, then it will have y plus alpha plus beta 1 x1 beta 2 x2. Yeah, so like that. Okay, and then lastly we have this epsilon. So here we are dealing with multiple x, so that's also possible. You can also get this kind of equation. Okay, so as I told you, we use to calculate this regression line equation, we use some formula. I will not go into the details of that formula currently. And but what we do is the way we calculate this regression line is this. It is called least squared method. So what we do is we have this difference. This is also called error, random error. Okay, this error, because we don't know why this difference has come because of some variable. We don't know what. So that's called error also. It's also called residual or error. Okay, and this is called, these values are called fits. Okay, so fits and the second values. So there is error. Okay. Now, this ice cream sales example. If we see here, now we have this equation. This is my y, okay. This is my slope, alpha, plus this is my beta, and this is my x. You can see here this equation. So when you enter this data in Minitab, Minitab will also calculate, or any other software, even Microsoft Excel also gives you this regression equation. So it will tell you what should be the, what is the equation. Okay, Minitab will also give you two things. One is called R square and the other is called R square adjusted. Now, what is the difference in R square and R square adjusted is? R square is when you have, this is a simple linear regression. So mostly the R square adjusted will be near to each other. But when you have multiple variables, like you have multiple X, you have only here one X, I have multiple X. And if I have want to have this equation, and if I keep on adding the variables, my R value keeps on increasing. But in R square adjusted, what happens is it, you know, it also reduces sometimes. If you keep on adding the variable, R square will increase, but R square adjusted may reduce. So ideally, we should look at the R square adjusted value here. That is 90%, which means my 90% variation in ice cream sales is explained by temperature. Okay, or there is 90% cases, if the temperature changes, the cells will change. Okay, so that is how, so it also means that there are 10% other causes for the ice cream cells, which are also there actually. Okay, so this is how we can also have this kind of equation, regression equation. So Minitab will give you this kind of summary, model summary, R square and R square adjusted. It will also give you this kind of another you know, analysis called ANOVA table kind of a thing. And it will also give you p-value. P-value means probability. Probability value means, it is again, you can say it is based on the hypothesis testing. Hypothesis is, null hypothesis is says there is no correlation. Both are equal. Okay, there is it's equal actually, there is no impact actually. And the alternative hypothesis is there is a correlation. Okay, so here p value 0 means there is a high correlation. Okay, so there is something called variation influence inflation factor, which is called VIF. So what we do when we do multiple regression, we also look at the correlation between the axes. Let's say here I have only temperature, but if I also add some other parameters like age of the people, okay, for example, who are coming to my shop, okay, if I add those kind of parameters, then I won't know, is it, you know, maybe the X1, that is temperature, and the age is also conflicting with each other. So I want to check this internal conflict, and that is possible through there is this index called VIF. So ideally we keep the VIF at If it is less than 5, we can assume that there is no collinearity between the axes. Okay, if there is a collinearity between the axes, we cannot create the model. Okay, so that's what we have to understand. Now let us have this equation. So what is the beauty of this equation is that now we have this ice cream cells, and I have this equation now. So can we predict if my cells, what will be the cells at 21 degree centigrade? So what I can do is I can just simply put it here. I will put 21 degree centigrade, okay, and I will get the ice cream cells by this mathematical formula. Okay, now, so let's say this is the case. So I'll have my ice cream cells. I can predict the ice cream cells value based on this model. Okay, now can I predict for 30 degree centigrade what will be my ice cream cells? Technically, no. Answer is no. Why we say no? Why you cannot predict for 30 degree? You can predict for 21, but you cannot predict for 30. Why? Because if you see the data that we have collected, the data we have collected is from 12 to up to 26. Okay. We have not collected data at 30. Or we have not collected data even beyond 30 or so, let's say 35 or something. Okay, I don't have any data point here. So I don't know, it behaves like this up to this point, but beyond this point, whether it goes in this direction or it goes straight or it goes curvilinear, I'm not sure. If I want to predict for 30, for example, let's say 30 or 35, maybe I have to have few readings at 30 or maybe more than that. Actually, I have to collect some sample data for 32 and 35 degree centigrade. Let's say I collect data for 32 and 35 degree centigrade, then I will create this plot equation again, then I can predict for 30. So I can only predict between my data range. Okay, I cannot predict beyond my data range. Okay, in case of regression, so extrapolation is not allowed. Okay, please, and there are other methods for extrapolation, not this particular. So please take care of this when you are using the regression equations. Okay, so what we do is we calculate the p value to determine whether there is any collinearity, whether there is any relationship or not. We check the r square value. Okay, we check the R square adjusted. Okay, usually we will look at the R square adjusted because R square adjusted take into account the other multicollinearity and other aspects also. Okay, so we have to actually look at the R square adjusted value, and we have to also look at the graph, that is scatter plot. Okay, and based on that we will see what is our model actually and what kind of correlation is there. Okay, so now let us come back to this case study which we were discussing. Let me open that file. So let's see in this case what they have done. Did they do any regression? Yes or no? If you see in the cause validation also, they have mentioned here very clearly that there are few points in this case study. They want to do regression. They have done regression. Here you see the regression. And this is on finished flow variation. This is on additional finish application. They have done regression. So let's see that regression chart. So here it is, the regression chart is there. So if you see here, there is this consumption, which is there Y. Okay. And there is this flow in liters. So, and then they have calculated the regression line. What is the R square adjusted value? R square adjusted is 50.7%. Okay, so this is, and p value is also zero. So this is, there is a high correlation in this actually. Okay, so 50%, almost half of the variation is explained by the flow. So if we control the flow, the consumption will reduce. Okay, now you can identify how to do this. So they have to control the flow. What they have done, you see, to control the flow, they have put two things in place. One is this pump was changed, and the meter also was changed. Okay, the flow meters were also changed. So like this, they have adopted these two methods to manage the flow based on this correlation analysis. Okay, let us see if other places they have done any other correlation. Okay. So for Finnish also, they have done the correlation here also. So this is a multiple linear regression. So here also we have this equation. Now you see here, consumption in kg per metric ton. This is my alpha plus beta 1. This is x1 plus beta 2, x2. So this also they have done in Minitab. Okay. So based on that, they have found out that there is a multicollinearity also they have checked with respect to this VIF value. So this VIF value is less than 5 here. So there is no multicollinearity. So now, based on this equation, your R square adjusted is again 64 and p value is 0. So they can, they have proved that, you know, this both this factor for flow and Finnish concentration put together can reduce the consumption by 64%. So there was 64% dependency is on these two parameters only. Okay. So that's how you actually apply this in Six Sigma projects. Okay. They have also checked multicollinearity with matrix plot. So here you see, this is a full matrix plot called. So this is Finnish flow, this is consumption, and this is Finnish concentration. So you can see the Finnish consumption in kg and Finnish concentration. This is okay, but if you see Finnish flow and consumption, there is this correlation. You can apparently see actually. So there is no correlation in two axes actually. So flow versus Finnish concentration, there is no correlation. Okay, so you can also check multicollinearity between two axes with this kind of graphical analysis. If there is a correlation between two axes, we cannot create the model. You know, we have to select the x which has high impact actually in that case. Okay, so that is what we do actually. Okay, any question in this? So let's go ahead actually. So
I think, sir, there is no question.
Okay, good.
We can go ahead.
Okay. So now, Larry, very quickly, we use some DFSS tools, so like PubMatrix. So this is used for comparing or benchmarking. So sometimes you want to find out the causes. What you do is you benchmark your process with some other process. And then you want to compare what is good in your process vis-a-vis what is good in the other's processes. So we use this kind of decision matrix. Okay? This is called a very good decision matrix. Called PubMatrix. Okay, so this was introduced by Stroud Pug. So that is why it is called PubMatrix. I have some noise now. Okay, thank you. So basically, you know, we want to usually this is used in DFSS, design for Six Sigma. So in design for Six Sigma, we want to, you know, collect the voice of customer, or we want to compare between two, which is better. So we can use this kind of PubMatrix, okay? So let me Yeah, so what happens is we can compare different concepts actually. Usually in design, we use this more. We want to compare two designs and which design is better. And if you want to benchmark our processes or our design, product designs vis-a-vis somebody else's design or somebody else's process, then we can create this kind of PERC metrics, okay? And we can, we can create. This is a very simple matrix actually, which we can, but very effective actually. I have personally used this particular matrix. So I will also show you how to use this particular matrix actually, okay? So these are the steps. So first we develop the criteria for comparison, okay, and then we examine the requirements. Usually if it is a DFSS project, we examine the requirements of customers, and we generate a set of engineering requirements or targets, okay. Then the second step is to select alternatives to be compared. So how are we going to compare this with the others, you know, benchmark designs or benchmark processes, okay? So we select those alternative designs or processes. Then we generate the scorecard, okay? There is, I have also given this YouTube link where you can also find this, how to do this, perform this actually. So the problem and then we give the scoring actually vis-a-vis the existing score. If you have existing design, you can do that, or you can compare between two different designs or two different processes, okay? And then we compute the score actually, okay, the total score actually, and then we can evaluate which one we would like to prefer actually, okay? So typically, you know, this and variation in the scores will tell us actually. So how do we, which are the options if you want to benchmark? So sometimes we also find out the causes, or I would say this is also used in solution phase, where we want to compare and we want to see which particular process we need to benchmark. How do we compare? How do we identify a good this thing actually, alternatives, okay? So you can select the alternatives based on this kind of scoring mechanism, okay? So let me show you actual example of this. Okay, I'll just share my screen. My son is now studying in college, and he is pursuing. I'll just stop sharing and share from other laptop. And my son, when he wanted to take admission, we created which college is better for him using PERC metrics. This is, I have applied, you can say, because I'm a Six Sigma person, I applied Six Sigma in selecting the college. You are all from academics, so this may be very interesting for you to know. So now you see here what I have done. This is a very simple thing, and this is actually what I have done. This is not which I'm sharing for any this thing. My son is, he wanted to pursue something called animation filmmaking, okay? So what we did, first of all, we created a design, you know, all the schools which are, all the colleges in India which are providing education on design. So we have this NID, which is number in Ahmedabad, and they are also at multiple. We have even IIT also, which is also having a design related courses, okay? Now we have this UID, we have this MIT in Pune, we have this GLS in Ahmedabad, ISTI in Mumbai, Paul in Mumbai, WWI, Whistling Wood International in Mumbai. So what we have done is, we have a list of all, we have first of all selected out of many these 9 colleges, okay? And then we have created this scoring mechanism. So this is actual PERC metrics. So what we have done is, we have decided the criteria. The first criteria that we decided was exposure. What kind of exposure is important? Is he going to get any exposure? in the campus, you know, because it's like the campus also very much. So how is the campus? Then we see the selected placement. How is the placement actually? Okay. Then affiliation, how they are affiliated with other international colleges and so on. Then we have infrastructure. Then we have the brand value. And then we have this total rating here actually. Okay. If you see this, yeah, here. So we have all these things actually now, this criteria. Now we decided how much importance we want to give to this criteria. So exposure, we wanted to give very good rating. So 5, we should get good exposure in this. They should have good exposure. Campus, we are giving only 2 rating. We say campus is not that important. Placement is very important. So we have given 5 rating. Affiliation is important, but not like placement, so we have given 4 rating. Infrastructure, we have, because in design school they should have software and hardware, so otherwise it's very difficult, so we have again given 4 or 5 rating. In brand, we have given 4 rating. Now what we have done is we have discussed with various people and we have put this rating. So we have put the rating in terms of +1, 0 or -1. So +1 meaning it is very good, it is highly recommended. 0 means it is at par with other colleges. Okay. -1 means it is not at par with other colleges, it is lower than the other colleges. Okay. So you see here we have given the rating 1, 0 and -1 for each of these colleges. Okay, for exposure, then we have given the rating for each of these colleges on campus. Okay. So like this, we have given all these ratings, and this is actual rating. And after doing all these things, we have now have the actual rating actually. So we have, what we have done is we have multiplied this with the this thing. So we can also have negative scores also possible. Okay. And this is how I get the rank actually. So if you see, our first preference was NID. Our second preference was WWI, and also second preference was IIT Mumbai. Okay. Now, since we tried first year, currently my son is studying in this college, East Lingwood International, which is in Mumbai, in the film city. So he is pursuing his study from this, because in NID he could not secure the admission. So now our second chance was WWI. So we selected WWI based on this score actually. Okay. So I hope, I think this is clear, but this is very useful in decision making. I mean, how do you take a decision? Okay. And this is practically possible even in your personal life also. You can use this kind of matrix if you want to purchase, let's say, some equipment, you know, let's say you want to purchase a television or you want to purchase a washing machine. And decide the criteria like this. You can select, and based on that, so there is no argument. You know, you can just sit with your wife, your family members, select the criteria and give this kind of rating, and there is no discussion actually. You can immediately make out which particular washing machine, which particular television you should select actually. You can compare the brands like this actually. Okay. So, and this I use very often in my personal life. You know, I like this tool very much for decision making, because I'm not, there are very less chances of making errors actually, okay, with this tool. Any question on this?
No, sir.
Okay. Okay, so let's go ahead now. Very quickly, we have some DFSS overview now. So DFSS stands for Design for Six Sigma. So till now, what we have discussed is DMAIC. So DMAIC is define, measure, analyze, improve, and control. You use DMAIC when you have already existing problems. You have some existing processes. But what if you don't have any existing process? Let's say there is a company which is being set up. This company is being set up is for the first time they are putting up that particular plant. Now they want to implement Six Sigma. You don't have any fast references. You don't have any existing processes, because the factory itself is not existing. The product is not existing. So how do you do this? Or you want to launch a new product. How do you do Six Sigma? Because you don't have any past data. So in that case, we use this kind of DFSS tool that is called Design for Six Sigma. So here in DMAIC, we follow these methods: define, measure, analyze, improve, and control. Okay. And this is the equation. And DFSS, we use a different terminology, which is called DMADV. Okay, so that is basically define, measure, design, analyze, design, and verify. So it is actually not DMAIC, it is basically DMADV. That is called Design for Six Sigma. And we use Design for Six Sigma related tools and techniques. The PUG matrix, which I explained you, is also used in DFSS. There is other tool called quality function deployment we use in DFSS project. There is a tool like Kano model. You also understood the Kano model only very briefly, but if you go into the Kano model in detail, there are a lot of things actually. So those tools are used in DFSS kind of projects. Okay, so we can also do design for Six Sigma rather than only working on existing projects. And why design for Six Sigma is important? Because you see, most of the time, if we can solve the problem right at the design stage, okay, that is the best place actually, because our cost of correcting the quality and reliability will be much less in that actually. Okay, so if you see here, this is the curve which shows if I'm able to correct the defects, or I am able to detect the defects right at the design stage, my cost will be much lower than when the product reaches to the customer. If the product has reached to the customer and then I have to do, like I have a lot of customer complaints and on that I'm doing a Six Sigma project. But again, it is too late already, because your product has been made, it has already been delivered to the customer, and then you are trying to, kind of improve actually. So what we do is, we try to, in DFSS projects, what we do is we try to fix as early as possible. The defects we want to fix as early as possible. And at that stage, it is very easy and it is less costly to fix the defects than compared to when the products have reached to the customer, services have reached to the customers, and then you are trying to fix it actually, okay? Here, the only problem is this, benefit is this. It is easy to see. Once it has reached to the customer, customer is shouting, so it is easy for you to recognize. Here, the only difficulty is this. The difficulty is that you won't be able to easily identify the defects. That's the complexity, okay? But we have to deal with that complexity. It is difficult to see, difficult to predict, okay? But that is the best Six Sigma project if you can do actually, DFSS kind of a project, okay?
Sir.
Yes.
Sir, DFSS approach is for only doing a new product, or if I want to redesign the existing product, can I use this DFSS approach, sir?
Yeah, you can, for existing product upgradation also you can use this, okay? Because then you don't want to repeat some of the past errors or past mistakes. You want to benchmark with others or something like that. And definitely you can also use this for, upgrading the existing products and services actually. Okay.
Okay, okay. Problem, in both scenario,
Yes, definitely, sir.
Okay.
Most of the cases, if you see in India, I have been consultant for now more than 23 years in industry. We have seen that in India, we don't spend much on research actually. So what happens is, even in industry also you go, what happens is they are always in a hurry to launch the product actually. And you launch the product with a lot of errors. And then you face all these difficulties. And then, you are trying to correct this and you compromise on the profitability and all that stuff. So it is always better to, if possible, to do this thing at the stage of design. We are working for one of the largest injection molding machine manufacturing company of India called Ferromatic Milacron. This company is now called Milacron India Limited. In this company, if you see, the productivity is now 5 times of what they were doing, around 6-7 years back. And also why they are selling more, because they are having now, they are selling more than 3,000 machines per year, injection molding machines. Okay. Now, one of the reason is they started Six Sigma with us in the year of 2012. And one of the Six Sigma project that the managing director took was to improve the reliability of the machines. Now, let me give you this very practical example. In India, or maybe other places also, when you manufacture machines, you give the warranty of the machine. You have warranty in everything that you receive, right? Your grinding mixers at home, or television or fridge, and even your car and everything, cycle, scooter, everything, you have a warranty. How do you decide the warranty in India? What is the basis of deciding the warranty? You ask this question to most of the manufacturers and they won't have any answer. You say, on what basis, for which part you are giving, how do you calculate this? This will not, you give warranty for 1 year, you give warranty for 2 years. On what basis are you saying this? What is the analysis that you have? I can bet you 99% of the companies don't have answer to this, because they have not done any reliability studies. So what in this company we did in Milacron was, we did a Six Sigma projects on reliability improvement. So they have various models, and we did a reliability study first of all. From the market, we collected the data of all the machines, and we calculated, statistically calculated the reliability, what is the probability of survival of this model in the market. So we came down from, approximately, we have around 20 models. So out of these 20 models, we came down to 5 models. I'm just giving approximate currently. 5 models which are having reliability issues. So these 5 models fail very frequently. Now these 5 machines, okay, 5 model of machines, what we did, we again did a reliability study at a sub-assembly level. So if this entire machine is there, which is a piece of, various sub-assemblies, so there are a lot of parts in injection molding machine. There is a clamp, and there is a toggle clamp, and there is this screw, and there is this, hitting element and all the stuff actually. So we did the sub-assembly level reliability study. In these 5 models, we identified sub-assemblies which are having low reliability. So we could identify the sub-assembly, let's say sub-assembly number 1, sub-assembly number 2 is having very less reliability. And then we came down to the parts, which parts are having low reliability. And then we worked on improving the design. We worked on improving the suppliers. Today, they are, because of this Six Sigma project that we had taken, the customers are so happy. Even in this pandemic, they were full of orders. They have now ordered for next 1 year, even today also. So this is one of the most highest, highly growing profitable company in India. You can see on LinkedIn, we have put their managing director's interview, and he's expressing everything what they have done actually openly. Okay, so this is what, you know, this is the DFSS projects are so powerful actually. That's what I want to say actually. You know? So we are basically moving from reactive approach to a proactive approach, from a reactive design to a proactive design. Even this is not something new. Even Dr. Deming also, Dr. Juran also used to say, the best place to improve quality is at the right design stage actually. That's where you can build the quality, okay? Otherwise, you can just detect the qualities, okay? So we want to change our paradigm from, in design, in reactive design, what we do is we are evolving the requirements. Here we have proper customer expectations. We design, rework is happening in the conventional DMAIC project. Here we control the critical design parameters. We build and test. Here we model, simulate, design. Okay, there is a tool called design of experiments. We use that tool actually to do proper experimentation. Okay, we have this from measurements, we want to go to statistical quality predictions, and from test in quality to design in quality. So this is what we do in design for Six Sigma. In pharmaceutical industries now it is becoming also mandatory. They call it QBD. Okay, so that is a new terminology. It is mandatory for all the pharma companies called QBD. QBD. So QBD is quality by design. Any company, any pharma company now in India, if you want US FDA approval, you need this QBD, mandatory. But other industries still, it is not the case actually, okay? So, as I told you, we have this various steps. Sometimes we also add a few more steps in DFSS. So we have define, measure, analyze, design, optimize, and verify. Okay, so we had also one stage called optimize before verify. So this is how we do these projects actually, okay? So let me just give you some idea about some tools that we can use in design. One is, of course, this PUGH matrix we can use for comparing the designs. We can use QFD. We can use Kano model. Okay. We can use DFMEA. We can use a tool called DOE, design of experiments. Okay, so these are some of the tools that we can use at for DFSS projects actually. Okay, and we can decide to design right first time. We have also done this with small companies also. We have worked with one company called Almex Electrical. They are manufacturing electrical terminals, and we have done right exactly what you were mentioning, existing product design. So they were having existing product, we wanted to upgrade the design, so we used the entire DFSS approach over there. So and then we did that actually. Okay, so next tool we use is called benchmarking. This is very simple tool. Basically what we do is we do the benchmarking. What we do in benchmarking is also a tool which is used in both DMAIC and DFSS both. Okay, so basically what you are doing is you are identifying and implementing the best practices from others, okay, in order to improve the performance. Okay, and this is what we do is we identify and we learn some of the best practices. We try to apply and adopt these best practices and all the outstanding practices that we have. Sometimes there are two different industries, but we can still benchmark actually. Sometimes we can benchmark from the similar industries. I'll also give you an example on benchmarking that we applied to our client actually, okay? So This is used to, you know, compare and to improve the performance actually. Now, why we should benchmark with others? The first reason is because we want to identify the opportunities for improvement. We want to know what we are doing better, what the others are doing better. Let me give ask you a very simple question. If I have to benchmark for standardization, which company you will benchmark? Can you give me any name of the company which is very good in standardization?
Toyota, sir.
Toyota, yes, definitely. Any other company that comes to your mind? Excellent example of standardization. I mean, this is one of world's best example of standardization.
Apple, McDonald's.
Go to McDonald's, any store. This, and I don't know, there is a, if you can go on YouTube, you will also find a movie on this McDonald's. There is also a movie which is made on this. This company, how are they selling? Everywhere you go, any country, will have same practices, no difference. If you go to one McDonald's store, you go to another McDonald's store, everything is same. There is hardly any difference, you know, apart from the size of the store. The way the kitchen is arranged is same. The kind of the utensils they use in the kitchen is same. The color of the tray in which they serve is same. You go to New York, you go to Japan, you go to Taiwan, everywhere it is same. I have traveled to Japan, I have traveled to USA, I have traveled to other countries also. I have seen everywhere McDonald's is the same. Okay. If they are putting your tray on the right side, everywhere they will put the tray on the right side only. If they take 2 minutes to prepare a particular kind of a burger, they will only take 2 minutes wherever you go in the world. Okay, so that's the best example of you know, best. So if you want to standardize, you know, I have many clients, I tell you very frankly, I have many clients and they say, you know, we want to standardize some processes. I tell them, take your team to McDonald's, let them have some small breakfast over there or some you know, meal over there. Let them experience, let them observe this, how they are doing best practices. Take them to another McDonald's store and see what kind of practices they are following. Can you learn from them? Can you understand from them what they are doing actually? Okay. These companies are best examples of standardization. These are best business models for a particular category. Okay. We must learn from this. Okay. And it is not that manufacturing companies cannot learn from McDonald's. I always encourage my all clients, wherever they want to improve standardization, I take them to McDonald's. I say, let us, you know, see what they are doing. Let's go to the another store and see also what they are doing. And you can you see the difference? It's all same. How are they doing this? In India, for example, HDFC Bank is another example. The high level of standardization. I have personally been, I know one of the senior person in HDFC Bank, the way they are practicing. It is one of the very fastest growing bank now actually in India. You can learn from others' experience. You can set realistic and ambiguous targets, because unless you compare, you don't know. There is this eye hospital in India which is following lean practices, which is now world's best lean practices. For example, I don't know, the Narayani Hospital or something like that, okay, in South India. Now that is in eye hospital, they are using lean management. That means all the operations are done in a flow manner, in a lean manner, okay. DDU, Dharamsi Desai University, is from Nadiad. In Nadiad, there is this kidney hospital, you know, that is also best example for lean practices, okay. So these are some realistic, once you visit this kind of facilities, you get a lot of ideas on what you should improve, what are the targets you should set. And you will also be able to understand your strength versus other strength, and you can prioritize and allocate the resources. Okay. So of course, the process of benchmarking is very, you know, we are not going into the detail, but the first stage is planning. Then we compare the data, we analyze, we create improvement plans, and we practice, improve the practices, and then we try to sustain the practices. Now, we have a client which is State Utility Center of Gujarat. This is called, this company is called Jetco. This is our client. So we were their consultant in 2007 and 2008. Okay. The entire management system of Jetco is designed by us. Okay. Entire management system. This is a state utility center. What they do is they transmit electricity. Now you see, electricity transmission means they are not distributing the electricity, they are just transmitting the electricity. That means there is a power generation center and there is a distribution company which is distributing the electricity. Like in Mumbai, there is Adani Electricity. This is their job is to take the power and supply the power to this distribution. And in between this, there is this transmission company. Okay. Now this company, if you can imagine, because in transmission company, they will have lines which are from 750 kVA substations to they will have up to 66 kV substations, and sometimes they have even 33, and the distribution companies have 11 kV substations. So they have all these substations, and from substations there is a line which is connected. So, and then ultimately this power is going to this 11 kV substation lines. Okay. Now you can imagine this one substation, which is 750 kVA. Okay. There, the lines which are going, this, if this substation is in shutdown, if let's say if this substation is shut down, maybe an area will go under dark. Okay, but when this substation is not working, or some lines in this substation is not working, the entire city will not have a light. Entire city cannot, will go powerless. So it's a huge impact actually. So maintenance is very important activity in these substations. So how do we do this? How do we do the maintenance? Now you do preventive maintenance, but if you have no extra spare capacity, which means you have to take plant shutdown. That means you will have to inform in advance that this line will be off and this line will be off and all that. But even in planned maintenance, your time to do the maintenance has to be very less. You cannot take more time to do plant maintenance also. That means you have to finish the maintenance as quickly as possible. So what we did is, you know, we compared, we said which is the best company for maintenance, which are the industry, and we came down to, we narrowed down our activities, that our activities are where you need very little time. So we benchmark with aircrafts maintenance. And what happens in aircraft? You see, this is very important to know, that we understood that in aircraft also, once the aircraft lands and the aircraft takes off, ideally you want your aircraft to run, it should be on the air. So between this time, you have to complete all the maintenance activities. And at the same time, the maintenance activity has to be perfect. I mean, this cannot have any kind of errors. So we went to the the airport, and we requested a few aircraft companies to allow us to visit actually. And then we understood from their maintenance system what is it that they are doing. So if you see, they have a very beautiful system of preventive maintenance. You know, all the aircraft companies have a very good checklist and very good system of standardization, checking and all this stuff actually. So the team of engineers from this Jetco visited these aircraft companies, and they created, they observed their practices, and then we created entire list of practices, what improvement is required in our processes. So one change we did was, for example, working on hotline. Now that time it was very new concept actually. That means we will work on the hotline. That means while the line is running, when the power is going from the line, we will do the maintenance. We need some technology for that, some equipments for that, safety equipments for that, and we use those equipment. So even while the line is transmitting the current, we can do the maintenance. Not necessary that we will do this kind. So these are some of the things that we have adopted from aircraft. You know, how can we reduce the time of preventive maintenance? So this is just one example of benchmarking. Okay, there are many such examples in benchmarking. Okay, so one of the best example of benchmarking is in the Second World War. This is very very good case study. In the Second World War, when you had to transport all the soldiers from one country to another country, because the entire world was fighting with each other, how do you transport or how do you move your soldiers from one place to another? How do you move your ammunitions from one country to another country? And how can you do this very quickly? Because you get order and you have to do this very quickly. So how do you do that? Can you imagine what did the benchmark with? In the Second World War, these countries who had to transport soldiers and the ammunitions, they benchmark with? They benchmark with circus. How the Russian circus, you know, the Russians are very famous in circus. They have animals, they have these gadgets, okay, they have this entire infrastructure. They very quickly wrap up everything and they very quickly move this in the ship. They have a very particular mechanism to store this in the ship and then transport this safely to the another country. So Russians are very good in the Russian circus were very good in you know, doing this kind of managing this kind of activity. In the Second World War, you know, this countries like America and all these countries, they adopted these practices from Russian circus. They studied Russian circus, how they are doing, and adapted the methodology. How can we quickly assemble the things? How can we quickly transport the things from one country to another country safely? Okay, so lastly, we have at analyze phase tollgate review. So basically, we have, as I told you, we have list of potential causes. So we'll do the review, and we have to ask these questions. What are the potential causes? How many potential causes did you identify? What tools did you use? Why did you choose those tools? And we have list of probable causes. And the questions that we ask is, did you narrow down to the probable causes? What tools did you use to narrow down to the probable causes? How did you validate the root causes? Again, what are the tools that you use? How did you validate? Which tool did you use to validate? And then we have final list of the root causes and which tool causes you the team focuses. So where are the which are the root causes you that you want to focus in improve phase and why? Now in improve phase you don't discuss about causes because the causes are validated, okay, already. And then we have something called stakeholder alignment. The stakeholder alignment means we go to the respective people team, because each Six Sigma project is always a teamwork. It is combination of various functions. So we have to update all the functions that these are the root causes that we have identified. And you have to also update the champions. You have to also update the executive committee on your analysis. If you have any resistance, if you have any arguments or resistance which is coming your way, you have to mitigate this appropriately before you go for the solution phase. Because from solution phase, you cannot come back, okay? So once after analyze phase, we always say, project charter is breached. You cannot change the project charter now. Up to analyze phase, we can make some modification in our project charter. After analyze phase, you cannot change your project charter. So that is what is required actually. So these are same questions I have put over here. Okay, so that's all from my side. Thank you. And if you have any questions, please let me know.
Sir, good morning, sir.
Yeah, morning.
Sir, what would be the research scope in Six Sigma, sir?
Research, you want to do research on Six Sigma?
Yes, sir.
I would first of all connect you to the person who has already done research on Six Sigma.
Okay,
I know this Dr. Darshak Desai. He's in Gujarat. He has done PhD in Six Sigma. And I'm also glad to say he has done his Six Sigma certification course from us, actually.
Okay, sir.
He has done his black belt from me. And he is now currently, he has completed his PhD on Six Sigma. He has also written a book on Six Sigma. The first thing I can do is I can connect you to Dr. Darshak Desai. You can connect with me on this. I mentioned my website also.
Sure, sir.
Through that or maybe through Shruti Madam, you can get in touch with me.
Sure,
and a lot of scope is there in Six Sigma. For example, I can tell you from my experience, I have worked with more than 1,200 companies now in my company, not me alone. And in 23 years. And there are a lot of scope because till now in India, Six Sigma is only applied to IT industries like software, ITES companies, and manufacturing. I would encourage you to identify Six Sigma applications in, one is in education, because in education still people are not using this kind of methodologies of statistical analysis. And if you see other countries like USA and all those places, so you can identify and do the research on how can we apply Six Sigma to educational institutes, what is the possibility, which are the areas, how can we improve the performance of educational institute using Six Sigma. That is one. And the other is healthcare. Huge application of Six Sigma is there in healthcare, actually. In healthcare, still in India, people are not focusing on proper continuous improvement methodologies. And if they apply this, there is huge opportunities are there for improvement in our healthcare system. So if anybody want to do a research on Six Sigma, I would say find out how can we apply in India the Six Sigma in healthcare and education.
Sure, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, welcome. IKEA, somebody has mentioned about IKEA. IKEA is good example of my favorite example, Mr. Raza, for benchmarking. Excellent, but it's very difficult to copy IKEA because they have a very unique business model, actually. Nobody is able to copy IKEA till now, actually. Yeah, so that's a good example. IKEA is a very good example, yeah. Now, there is a question of suggesting Mr. Purant that suggests the criteria for benchmarking the performance of educational institutes. Now, I would request you to, I don't know how many of you know about this, but in India, we already have a framework for education. Okay, if you want to understand in education, how do you, improve the performance, actually, okay? So we have already some criteria which is there, actually. So I will just give you this link also. Let me just copy this link and let me share this. Download this document which I have put in the chat box. In India, there is this organization called RPNQA. This is Ramkrishna Bajaj National Quality Award. And they give you a performance benchmarking for educational institutes. So you see here, there is this educational institute guidelines also. You can download this free. I have already posted this in chat box. So RBNQA is a performance excellence criteria. And there is a separate guidelines for educational institute. I am a senior examiner of RBNQA since 2011. And I have seen a lot of educational institutes which are having a lot of best practices in India. I have personally, been assessor to VIT in Pune, Vishwakarma Institute of Technology. I have been personally assessor to Global Indian School, If you know, I don't know how many of you know about Global Indian School. Global Indian School is one of the best benchmark school in the world actually now. This is an Indian school and they are operating in multiple countries now, not only in India. Global Indian School is in India also. And also it is there in Singapore, Japan and other places also. And the kind of practices they have is phenomenal. Last year, I evaluated the students who did some of the quality improvement projects, you know. So they are encouraging students also to do some kind of quality improvement projects. And also, you can if any of your institute, I am also secretary of American Society for Quality. If you are interested to know benchmarking and starting a student chapter kind of a thing in your college, you can also get in touch with me. We have four colleges in India, in Gujarat, where we have a student chapter running for quality improvement. So we can also help you in that.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, I have a doubt in regression analysis.
Yes.
Yeah, in that VIF value, if it comes more than 5 minutes, so what should we have to do, sir? We cannot do that regression analysis, or we have some other...
No, we can do. Mm. But what we have to do is, we have in linear regression, we do not want multicollinearity. Multicollinearity means my X and X is having internal correlation. You know, X1 and X2 is having internal correlation. So in that case, what I will do is I will not consider both the axes because they are already correlated with each other. So what I have to do, I have to take one of the X rather than both the axes. Okay. So what I will do is I will still do the analysis, but I will identify which X out of these two which are having internal correlation should I consider. And then I will build my model.
Oh, okay. The primary prerequisites that all X's should not be correlated. Generally, we have to.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Because if X are already internally correlating with each other, you don't get. Taste, and then you can find out which X you want to focus. Okay. And if the two X's, X1, X2, is correlating with each other, you have to select one of these. Now, which one will you select? It depends on your situation, where the data is easy to collect.
Okay.
I'll just go by that. Okay. So this is a practical decision then, or where it is important. For example, that I say no, this X is more important, then I can select that X. But I will remove the other X because it is already having internal correlation. Okay.
Okay, sir. Okay. Thank you.
Mm. Welcome. In example which I gave, electricity, benchmark, aircraft, both industries are different. So just to know, how could it be judged? See, I tell you, this is an example of cross industry benchmark. I gave you example of this Second World War, when they are also comparing how the crew members can be transported from one country to another country very quickly. You get the order within 5 minutes, you have to pack and you have to ship everything. How do you do that? Circus is doing that very well. So what they are doing is, if you see the circus, their cages are designed in quick changeover method actually. It's very quick changeover. I always say this, the circus, old day circus, they have a very good mechanism. So Mr. Mandar, what we can do is a cross industry benchmark is also possible. We are not electricity is not in the aircraft business, but we have to understand how they manage the schedules. How do they manage the time? How do they, prepare themselves before maintenance? How do they get the information that my, aircraft is coming? What kind of planning system they are adopting? All those practices I can definitely benchmark, and I can put this in practice actually. Thank you. R and R square value is basically, R is called, so if you see the small R value, it was ranging from -1 to +1. So the small R value gives you direction. Okay, where, in which direction? Is it a positive correlation or it is a negative correlation. The R squared is not giving you direction. It is only giving you strength of the correlation. So if my small r value is plus 1, that doesn't, plus 9, it doesn't mean I have 90% correlation. It means I square it, so it means it has 81% correlation. So the one thing is giving me direction, the other thing is giving me the percentage of strength. Mr. Senthil, Dr. Senthil.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. How it is r adjusted varies, values is varied from this r square value.
So there is a simple formula for that, actually. Okay, but I'll tell you the logic. The logic is this. If I say I have a model where I have one y and two x, okay, and let's say my r square is 50%, okay. Now I add third x into the model. What will happen? R square will again increase. As you keep on increasing the predictors, your R square will always increase. Okay, because that's a formula of R square. Okay. Now what happens in R square adjusted is that if you add the next R next x3 in that particular model, maybe R square adjusted either may reduce or may not increase that much, actually. So ideally what we should consider is R square adjusted only.
Okay, sir.
So when you keep on adding predictors, R square will keep on increasing, but when you keep on adding predictors, R square adjusted may or may not increase. So how you do this in actual practice is you keep on adding x in the, this is called step by step regression. If you see in Minitab, they also have this step by step regression model.
Shall I consider the optimized value R squared or adjusted value as optimized value?
Optimized value, yes. So there is this step by step regression method also available in Minitab, actually. Okay, so here it is not coming now.
Okay, sir.
But there is a step by step regression model. So what we can do is we can do step by step regression. So usually we do regression in step by either upward or downward. So what I do upward means I keep on adding x, downwards means I add all x and then start removing the x. And now what I will do is I will see r and r square both. The moment I don't see that by adding r, by adding one more x, my R square adjusted is not increasing much, I will not consider that as my true predictor.
Okay.
I hope you are able to understand.
Yeah. Understand. Yes, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. So, that's all from my side now. So, if anybody who wants to get in touch with us, you can get in touch with through Shruti Rawal. She is our point of contact. And thank you very much for listening to me. And I hope you have enjoyed this. If you have any query, any doubt, please feel free to get in touch with us. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir, for this informative and wonderful session. We learned a lot of new things from you, sir. Thank you very much for accepting our invitation and be a part of this FDP. Thank you so much, sir. Have a good day, sir.
Thank you.
The next session will be started.